having had the high honor of serving the 42nd President of the United States at the White House, I want to start today's program congratulating President-elect Joe Biden and Vice President-elect Kamala Harris. And also congratulations to the Latino community who showed up to vote in a big way. An estimated 20.6 million voters, over 8 million more than 2016. Good afternoon. I am Mickey Ibarra, founder and chairman of the Latino Leaders Network, host of this 63rd Latino Leaders Luncheon Series. Thank you for joining us at this virtual event staged live at the Paramount, located in this historic Boyle Heights community of Los Angeles. As we continue bringing leaders together to establish relationships, build unity, and share our personal stories during the devastating impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on our community. On behalf of the Board of Directors, I want to express our gratitude for your support during a challenging year that required us to pivot from the 32nd Tribute to Mayors, convened in Washington, D.C. on January 22nd with 355 dinner guests, to convening now six consecutive virtual events, reaching nearly 45,000 viewers. We will add to the total today to conclude our 2020 events calendar, honoring Antonia Hernández, recipient of the Eagle Leadership Award, and the Honorable Richard Alatorre, the Chairman's Award. At this time, before continuing the program, we would like to take a moment of silence in memory of the thousands who have lost their lives to COVID-19. May they rest in peace, never forgotten. Thank you. For welcome remarks, we are going to hear now from Mayor Eric Garcetti. Mayor Garcetti is no stranger to the Latino Leaders Network, having also been honored by the Latino Leaders Network in 2015 with our Chairman's Award, and also in 2018 with our Eagle Leadership Award. Mayor Garcetti will now deliver a recorded message at this time.
Hello, I'm Mayor Eric Garcetti. It's always a pleasure to be with my Latino Leaders Network family, and I'm so honored today to join Chairman Mickey Ibarra, former Assemblymember Richard Alatorre, and Antonia Hernández, each a source of strength and light in our city. This week, Americans from coast to coast are breathing a cathartic sigh of relief. The tension that we've held in our hearts is starting to ease. And after a long and somber night, we are seeing the first lights of a new dawn. For our Latino community, for many members of this network, these 4 years have been especially dark. We've spent them fending off vicious attacks, battling for our most basic rights, living in a nation that suddenly was becoming unwelcoming and unsafe. We saw parents ripped from children, kids tossed into cages, dreamers sent back into the shadows. Our people have been through trauma. We've endured a season of suffering whose scars will long remain, and we are exhausted. Yet through it all, we've tapped into a key part of the spirit and character of our community. We know struggle, and we know what it takes to defy the odds. Ours is a heritage of ordinary people who built coalitions stronger than any unjust policy, and that made changes that endured long after the abuses faded away. That's what lifted up the farm workers who rose up along Cesar Chavez and Dolores Huerta, who marched and organized and fought until the rights achieved in the fields of Delano rang out across our nation. That mission motivated Latino voters this year in every city and every state to show up at the polls and send our voices and our values to the chambers of Congress and the corridors of the White House. That tradition is what America's first Chicano poet laureate, Juan Felipe Herrera, meant when he wrote, "La libertad viene desde muy adentro." Freedom comes from deep inside. That history, that unbroken chain of builders and fighters, thinkers and dreamers, that is our strength. That is who we are. You know, this week I've been thinking of my grandfather Salvador, an immigrant from Mexico who fought for our freedom in World War II before earning his American citizenship. He knew that the blessings of liberty were never a given. They have to be fought for and earned by leaders of vision and individuals of goodwill. And that's a lesson and a legacy we will never forget. So as we close the book on this chapter of history and chart a new path forward, let us never stop marching for a more just America, a place where everyone belongs, a nation that lives up to its promise, just as it did for my family and for so many of yours. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of the event.
Thank you, Mayor Garcetti. And now a word from our premier sponsor, the Coca-Cola Company, represented by Peter Villegas, Vice President and Head of Latin Affairs. He's a member also of the California State Athletic Commission. He is our champion at the Coca-Cola Company, and we are grateful for his friendship. Please welcome Commissioner Peter Villegas for premier sponsor remarks. Peter?
Good afternoon. They can talk back, right, Mickey? Good afternoon. Oh, thank you, Mickey, for that kind introduction, and welcome to Los Angeles, home of the world champion Los Angeles Dodgers and world champion Los Angeles Lakers. Yes, they represent our city, what champions are about. Mickey, thank you for doing the Latino Leaders Network into the board. You really see how important relationships are during these challenging times, how important it is to have deep, true, impactful relationships so that we can stay together, stay connected when this unfortunate year has been trying to keep us apart. So thank you for that, Mickey. Thank you to the honorees, Richard Alatorre. Thank you for all you have done. I think today there's over 6,000 plus Latino elected officials at all levels of government. You were one of the first and really helped create a template and a structure for others to follow, not just in Los Angeles, but throughout the country. Thank you for all you've done, sir. And then I can't say enough about Antonia Hernández, who, when I had hair, worked at American Savings Bank. She really took me under her wing and helped me show what a corporate representative can and should do, represent the company, but get engaged in the community beyond just the resources. Roll up your sleeves, put in some sweat equity, advocate. It was the first board that I joined, MALDEF, and true admiration. First time besides my mom that I got to see a powerful, intelligent, empowered, tactful Latina run the show. And you've been doing it ever since. So thank you. Thank you for that. So thank you for being here. Thank you for supporting. Thank you, Mickey. And I'd like for you to see a video of what we're doing over here at Coca-Cola. Thank you very much.
The day the world stopped was the day we found where to go. Lost together, we discovered ourselves again. And we realized that the things that matter deserve time. From now on, we're not going to leave anything on our plates. Because we've learned to savor the moments that were always there. And they never tasted this good.
For special guest remarks, we are delighted to be joined by the newest member of the Los Angeles City Council, Kevin De Leon, who took the oath of office last month to represent the 14th Council District, which includes the Paramount. Councilmember De Leon is the California State Senate President Emeritus and a former member of the California Assembly as well. The councilman and I had the opportunity to work together at the National Education Association headquarters in Washington, D.C. before he returned to California. It gives me a great deal of pleasure to present Councilmember De Leon for guest remarks.
Well, good afternoon to each and every one of you. To Mickey, thank you very much for that kind introduction. To all the special guests here today, welcome to CD14 here in the heart of the great historic community, the neighborhood of Boyle Heights. Mr. Mayor Villaraigosa, who I just saw just a quick second ago, I don't know if he's still right over there, they got a television set covering Mr. Mayor. Felicidades, welcome back to your neighborhood here in Boyle Heights. Again, it's indeed an honor and pleasure to be here with each and every one of you. A couple things. One is to the great, you know, Antonia Hernández. It has been wonderful to work with you. You are a pillar of strength, not just to young girls and young women and women altogether, but you are a pillar of strength and, in fact, a role model to young boys, young men, as well as men. The way you carry yourself with a sense of dignity and respect, you don't ask for permission, that you own your space and you speak truth to power is an example that all of us, whether you're an elected official or not, aspire to be like. So the Eagle Award, el Águila, el reconocimiento that you're being bestowed on today is incredibly well-deserved. You are owed so many more recognitions, but I wanted to make sure, you know, speaking with Mickey in our long-standing pre-existing relationship, that I had a few moments to speak about who you are, and obviously knowing each other back in the days when you were at the helm of Maldef, and you know, I was, you know, just a young scrapper, you know, working for a nonprofit agency here in Whittier and Esperanza Boulevard, a one-stop immigration, and our two worlds, you know, the confluence of us coming together today and working on 187. I want to thank you for your incredible decades of service. And by the way, you know, and this is just me, Antonia Hernández, and you know, whether she concurs with me or not, I think is irrelevant to the point because it's my opinion and, you know, I adhere to my opinions and my thoughts. But I think that Antonia Hernández could easily have been our first Latina U.S. Supreme Court justice in the history of the state of the history of the United States of America. And I think that's one of those chapters will be told, you know, soon by historians, you know, of how that happened, or perhaps it didn't happen because the influence you had in the Senate Judiciary Committee back in the day in U.S. Senate was quite incredible and immeasurable. So let's please give it up for Antonia Hernández, everybody. Te quiero mucho, Antonia. You're a real hero for all of us. To someone who I affectionately call, I've always called actually the chairman of the boards, you know, is being honored today as the chairman, you know, recognition. Here today. We have a nexus because he served in the State Assembly as chair of the Rules Committee. I was a member of the Assembly, and then I left and went on to become a member of the California State Senate, and as Mickey just mentioned a few moments ago, the leader, first time in, 133 years to be a person of color and a Latino to lead the California State Senate. But you know, prior, you know, to Richard Alatorre, this seat was held by a non-Latino, Art Snyder. And Mr. Richard Alatorre, after serving his time in the California State Assembly, came back to Los Angeles to be the leader of the City Council District number 14. And by the way, he is one of my most high-maintenance constituents in CD14, you know, if you didn't know. You know, he lives in a very Tony wealthy enclave north of Colorado Boulevard. In fact, north of Hill Drive in Eagle Rock, which within City 14 is the most high expensive zip code there is. You know, I say leave Eagle Rock, come back to Ball Heights, Mr. Chairman. And, but nonetheless, you have been a model of strength for so many elected officials, not just elected officials, but activists, you know, just like Antonia, who speak truth to power, folks who walked in the hallways of corporate boards, folks where people of us, con nuestro rostro, you know, are not represented. Thank God we have someone like Peter Villegas in a Fortune 500 corporation, you know, based in Atlanta, Georgia. People who look like him and people like Mickey, you know, in D.C., you know, by way of Utah, who has been a very sharp tip of a spear to make sure that we have diversity, to make sure we have inclusivity in spaces that historically people like us, Latina women and Latina men, have not occupied, you know, whether it be the federal bench or the state bench, whether it be corporate boards, whether it be places in Washington, D.C. Lastly, I'll just say the following. This is an inflection point in our nation's history, unlike anything we have ever witnessed or experienced before, especially with the coronavirus 19, where people of color, in particular Latinos who have been disproportionately impacted by the coronavirus, whether it is lack of accessibility to employment and therefore not able to pay the rent, utilities, or food for their children. That's why we have to speak truth to power, because during this inflection point, one thing that is increasingly apparent is either our voices are not being heard, or our actual physical presence in our culture and who we are is not being acknowledged during the debate of how we deal with equity, you know, and how we make sure that regardless of who you are and the color of your skin and who you love and, you know, what your gender is and yes, your legal status, that as Latinos, as human beings, we all deserve dignity and respect. And that's why, you know, I cannot think of two, you know, more prominent individuals that have had an impact in my life, in the life of so many, not just Latinos, but non-Latinos as well, as Antonia Hernández and Richard Alatorre. So to my good friend Mickey, you know, thank you very much for doing what you do throughout the country, but especially here in Los Angeles. Gracias a todos. Gracias. Buen día.
The Latino Leaders Luncheon Series is made possible by the generous support of good corporate partners, and we want to recognize all our sponsors today. Edison International, our network sponsor, Alejandro Esparza. Southwest Airlines, the official airline of the Latino Leaders Network, Kelly Knox. Anheuser-Busch is our book giveaway sponsor. 300 program viewers will have the opportunity to receive a complimentary copy of Latino Leaders Speak, courtesy of Anheuser-Busch. Thank you, Julio Suarez. We also have a great group of VIP sponsors, HDR Inc., David Cobb, Fernandez Cervantes, Government Affairs, Zoila Fernandez, David Ibarra Enterprises, Airbnb, John Choi, Geico, MacArthur Stephen, and Rick Baker of Atlanta. We are grateful also to LATV, the only remaining Latino-owned TV network, serving as our event media partner. They do a great job of telling our stories in LA and around the country. And finally, I also want to thank Frank Acevedo and Chef Mario Cristerna, owners of the Paramount, and Kimmy Wade for their vision and hospitality. At every Luncheon Series event, the Latino Leaders Network features a community partner doing good for the Latino community. The United Latinx Fund is a leading foundation and philanthropic resource created in Los Angeles, which uplifts our community and quality of life. We welcome Richard Xavier Corral, Interim Executive Director and Principal Consultant of Corral Consulting, to tell us more.
Good afternoon. I'd like to personally congratulate Antonia Hernández for your commitment and excellence in our community. Thank you for your service. I'd also like to thank Mickey Ibarra, Norma Vega, and the entire Latino Leaders team for honoring ULF, United Latinx Fund, as this year's community partner, which also serves to commemorate ULF's 30th anniversary. Over the past three decades, ULF has partnered with public agencies, elected officials, academia, business leaders, media, and of course, our Latinx community, to emerge as Los Angeles's leading foundation and philanthropic resource created for and by Latinx that transforms, uplifts, and improves the quality of life throughout Greater Los Angeles. We do this by investing in sustainable, community-driven solutions led by local nonprofits that deeply impact the communities that they serve. So when the COVID-19 pandemic struck, followed by national civil unrest, protesting police violence, it became clear that the Latinx community was disproportionately impacted with each escalating issue. In response, ULF quickly pivoted to reimagine our business model in order to innovate responsive solutions, virtually engage, and secure new resources for our community. For example, we partnered with the Latino Coalition of Los Angeles, and we launched the Campaign for Nonprofit Resilience as an urgent call to action to local leaders to advocate, educate, sustain our most essential nonprofits that potentially would shutter due to the pandemic. We also launched a weekly virtual fireside charla event series. So across 27 episodes, 30 leaders, over 800 live attendees, the charla series continues to provide a real-time virtual platform for a diverse cross-section of local and national leaders to share the specifics of their policies, investments, and programs that address the immediate challenges, as well as how these solutions work to rectify endemic inequalities throughout communities of color. Through ULF's community grant program, we've invested over $1 million in more than 600 community-based organizations, thanks to the generosity of employee workplace giving campaigns. And I'm proud to share that ULF is on track to exceed our previous year's giving for the third consecutive year in a row. And like the Latino Leaders Network, ULF is also committed to uplifting our next generation. During the pandemic, ULF invested in young social impact professionals by providing employment, practice opportunities, and mentorship on rapid response advocacy campaigns, media, and online production projects. Given the recent election and the record number of Latinx voters, centering our community's diversity within national conversations on policy and philanthropic investments is more imperative than ever. And to that end, ULF is actively engaged in conversations with Latinx leaders nationally that would like to start a ULF chapter in their community. So, if you'd like to join that conversation, please drop us a line at info@UnitedLatinxFund.org. Again, that's info@UnitedLatinxFund.org. And we look forward to hearing from you. Mickey, many thanks again for recognizing ULF's important work. And we look forward to working with all of you very soon. And for those of you in the room, as a token of our esteem and appreciation, each of you will find a ULF face mask in your gift bag. Thank you and have a great afternoon.
Periodically, at this event, the Chairman's Award is presented to an outstanding leader from our community. It has been presented only 9 times previously. The Honorable Richard Alatorre has earned the Chairman's Award, given his 26 years of leadership and public service in the California State Assembly and the Los Angeles City Council. The Honorable Gloria Molina, a past recipient of our Eagle Leadership Award, former Assemblywoman, City Council member, and County Supervisor, has agreed to deliver the tribute to our honoree.
Hello, everybody. Well, it is indeed my honor to make this presentation. Richard Alatorre has been known as one of the state's most influential political leaders. I know that when Antonio Villaraigosa was mayor of the city of Los Angeles, he called on Richard from time to time for advice on strategy. And that has been true of many leaders throughout the state. He has mentored various elected officials, and he has been responsible for many of them getting elected. He himself was elected in 1973 with a small group of Latinos from throughout the state. And together they coalesced and formed the Chicano Caucus, of which he became its first chair. He was responsible in the state legislature for various important and significant legislation for our community, including rights for farm workers to collectively bargain. He was involved in the Bilingual Services Act. He did a lot in bilingual education, and he also passed legislation for bilingual consumer assistance. And of course, we all know his legendary work in reapportionment in the state. He created many an opportunity for Latino to get elected throughout the state. He moved on to the city council, as was mentioned before, and of course was the first Latino since Congressman Ed Roybal served on the city council. And again, he championed many a cause there. He was responsible for bringing together and regionalizing our transportation system, which of course has created a regional transit system throughout Los Angeles County. And of course, he was called upon as well to handle its city council reapportionment, in which again, he created opportunities for Latinos to run for office. So he has, of course, influenced much legislation and influenced many leaders. He has written a book that talks about change from within, because I think that's the unique talent that Richard Alatorre has, is working on the inside, building relationships, coalescing people together, and moving forward legislation that in many instances would not even have a chance of passing. He's truly a Chicano warrior, very deserving of this award. So it's my honor to present Richard Alatorre with the Chairman's Award of the Latino Leaders Networks. Congratulations, Richard.
Thank you very much, Gloria. She was one of them that was decided that it was time to support women and remember the fights that we had. But, you know, she deserves, you know, everything that she worked for. And now that she's on retirement, she continues to advocate on behalf of our community. I served in the California legislature for almost 15 years, at which time, you know, we had decided amongst a few of us that there was a need for an organization to be the advocates for change. And I remember being in Miami, Florida, and Lou Moret, who is here, who was my first campaign manager, my first administrative assistant. You know, we decided that we were gonna form a caucus. Knowing that nobody else wanted to do it made it fairly easy for me to say, I will do it. And from there, there was five people at the time in 1973. And you fast forward to today, where I think we have over 30 elected state senators or state assemblymen. But the important thing that I've learned over the years of being in elected office was the fact that it's one thing to be an advocate, but what's important is to make sure that the things that are important to our community, whether it is in Los Angeles, whether it's in Delano, California, whether it's in San Jose, is having networks that can become advocates not only in politics, but also in other social endeavors. And if we look at the things, if I look at my past, the important thing was not only the position, but also the people that we were able to interest in elected office and interest in a wide variety of things that have to happen in the social arena in local areas in California. And I've had that privilege to serve. I loved the time that I was in a public office. You know, there's a lot of gives and a lot of takes. It's not always easy, but you know, I had a commitment growing up, being born not too far from here at the White Memorial Hospital. I was born there, lived in Boyle Heights for a short period of time, and then I moved to the Beverly Hills of East Los Angeles, Amaravia. And it's a community that, you know, many of us know that have lived in this area, and it was the beginning of my career. And I just want to just thank Mickey for the challenges that he undertakes, the work that he does in acknowledging people. But more important than just acknowledging the people, what's more important is making sure that the people that are acknowledged are the ones that are helping to make this country a better country, to help out a community that many times is misunderstood. And if there is anything that we have learned this year, and that is the importance of electing somebody that is going to not only tell us what we want to hear, but once that the deed is accomplished, like in the case of President-elect Joe Biden, but making sure that the promises are in fact fulfilled. And we're going to have, it isn't going to be an easy task. When you go from a person that wanted to kill us, wanted to deport us, wanted to separate our children, wanted to take away the use of a language, which is the language that is secondary to us. It's primary to us, I should say. But, you know, I believe that with the people that not only are viewing, that are here today, that those things can be accomplished. And I thank my friend Mickey Ibarra for this recognition. Thank you very much.
Congratulations, Richard. We will deliver the Chairman's Award after the event. Now for the presentation of the Eagle Leadership Award to Antonia Hernández. Antonia, on behalf of the Latino Leaders Network, we are pleased to present you with our Eagle Leadership Award for your outstanding service to the Latino community and our country. Miguel Santana, member of our Board of Directors, President and CEO of the Los Angeles County Fair Association, and next President and CEO of the Weingart Foundation, will deliver the honorary tribute, followed by Antonia's keynote remarks.
Good afternoon. Antonia, this is how she is known by our nation's most powerful and influential. From US presidents and senators, Supreme Court justices, billionaire philanthropists, governors, and mayors. But what she is most proud of is that she's known as Antonia from our nation's most marginalized. Undocumented immigrants, the unhoused, parents whose children have been denied a quality education. Antonia Hernández rightly deserves to be known by her first name in Los Angeles and around the country. For nearly five decades, our community has called on Antonia for her guidance, leadership, and advocacy. I first met Antonia when she interviewed me to be her community affairs assistant at MALDEF. With the embers of the 1992 civil unrest still smoldering, she hired this young Chicano straight out of college to assist her in bringing together the emerging Latino political leadership under one agenda. I couldn't have asked for better training for a career committed to public service. But frankly, I'm not the only one. There are hundreds of leaders in business, philanthropy, politics, and the nonprofit sector who have learned from her example. We are her disciples. We have placed the community's interest ahead of all others. It is hard to imagine in LA without Antonia Hernández. Who would have confronted LA County for the forced sterilization of Latinas in the 1970s? Would there have been the first Latina elected to the powerful County Board of Supervisors? Would Prop 187 be the law of the land today? Indeed, dozens of other victories have been fought and won due to Antonia's steady, committed leadership. Today, Antonia runs a $2 billion community foundation that invests in building hundreds of units for the unhoused, ensures that everyone gets counted in the census, and advocates for justice and equality for our community. I am proud to serve on the California Community Foundation Board, where I get to see firsthand her unique ability to get the powerful and the rich to fight for and invest in our most marginalized. And starting next year, as Mickey said, I am proud to call her a colleague. On behalf of the Latino Leaders Network, I am proud to present Antonia Hernández with the Eagle Leadership Award to our friend, our mentor, and advocate. Thank you.
Buenas tardes to everybody, and thank you to Mickey for this wonderful recognition. I know that I am speaking to folks throughout the United States, but allow me to be local for a few minutes. I want to recognize the folks in this room. You know, the Chairman's Award was given to Richard Alatorre. We go back probably six decades. We graduated from Garfield High School.
and his lovely wife Angie and I were in the drill team at Garfield High School. I tutored the troublemaking Mayor Antonio Villaraigosa back in the late 60s. And my best friend, Gloria Molina, who we've been friends for over four decades. It takes a village and a whole bunch of other people to struggle together on behalf of our community. And I'm so proud to be in a room with some of my closest, dearest friends. And now to the larger community who is here and participating via virtual. I'm a Chicana. I am an immigrant. And the message I want to give to millennials is to embrace who you are. The language that you speak is not a deficit, but an asset. Embrace it and do not forget it. And the culture, our culture, who we are, is what makes us unique and gives added value to the mix of what America is. This is our home. This is our land. And for the millennials, the future is yours, but you are walking on the footsteps of many who struggled. Whether you're in corporate America, whether you're in politics, whether you're an advocate, step up to your purpose. And your purpose is to represent your community. And our community is not homogeneous. Our community is diverse. The Guatemaltecos, Salvadoreños, Argentina, Mexicanos, we're the same and yet we're different. But one message I want to give to the rest of the audience, the rest of the world doesn't know the difference. And if you think that you are different, let me tell you, after five decades of struggle, they paint us with the same brush. But that's okay. We are Americans, and we're going to put our imprint to this society as we have done in the past. It is our obligation to represent our community. It is not an onus. It is a privilege. As an immigrant, this is my hood. I am standing in the neighborhood that I grew up in. In high school, I worked at a store on Brooklyn and St. Louis. In 1974, I started my legal career at Model Cities, three blocks away. And on the first floor was the legal office. For those in the art community, the second floor was Sister Karen, who started self-help. It is those struggles that we have to take on the responsibility. I have spent most of my life, well, with the exception of the last 17 years, fighting for political empowerment. But political empowerment is not enough. One lesson I have learned is that we have to have economic empowerment. Good jobs, starting businesses, showing the way. As a communal community, it's our family. I came from an ejido, it's a rancho. It's my cousin from 3 degrees who I never met, who my mother says es tu primo, okay? It's our town, it's our hood. It is our obligation to make it better for everyone. And as Richard said, we are in a transitional period. The future of this country rests upon us. It's not what's good for the Latino community, because what's good for the Latino community is good for the country. And I leave you with this message. Don't make the mistake of the past. When we bring ourselves up from our bootsteps, we have to bring everybody else. It is our obligation. Thank you very much. It is a privilege to receive this award. Thank you.
Well said, Antonia, and congratulations. And And like the Chairman's Award, we will deliver the Eagle Leadership Award after the program. Prior to closing the program today, I'm thrilled to present Las Cafeteras, who recorded a special tribute to our honorees, performing their hit song, La Bamba. Viewers, welcome East LA's very own Las Cafeteras.
Welcome to Los Angeles. Mickey and the entire Latino Leaders Network familia, all your primos and primas, everybody on the line, we are Las Cafeteras, and we're excited to have you right here in our hometown. Now, we're going to honor two special guests today, Antonia Hernández, President and CEO of the California Community Foundation, and Richard Alatorre, former California Assemblyman. A los dos, felicidades. Now, this musical tribute goes out to our honorees, and it goes out to each and every one of you out there fighting fearlessly so that our communities can have a brighter day and a brighter mañana. This goes out to all you rebeldes out there. This is La Bamba Rebelde. Órale, banda, let's get it cracking.
Se, ome, ye, nawi.
Que se acabe la bamba, que se acabe la bomba, me encontré suena. Ahí arriba, ahí arriba, esa. Ahí arriba, ahí arriba, ahí arriba, ahí arriba. Yo no creo en fronteras. Yo no creo en fronteras. Yo cruzaré, yo cruzaré, yo cruzaré.
Thank you, Las Cafeteras. I want to also thank Jaina Donair, Jaime Lopez, and our event volunteers, as well as the Twins PR and Suburban Video for helping produce this event. Remember, all of you who registered will be emailed a gift certificate, redeemable, a 300 book limit, for a complimentary copy of Latino Leaders Speak and our curriculum guide. This now concludes the program. Please view our exciting 2021 calendar of events at latinoleadersnetwork.org. Thank you for viewing.